Praise the Lord. Let's give a shout to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Thank you. Praise you, Lord. He's good. He's good. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the holy name. Bless your holy name, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. You're a good God. You're more than enough. You have more than enough to meet all my needs. Supply all my needs. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We love you, Lord. And we're here to praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Jehovah Jireh, He is my God.
Lord. We worship you, Lord. You're holy. You're righteous. You're mighty. You're a great God. Oh, hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. You're here to meet our needs. We need you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Open your mouth and worship our King. Hallelujah. Glory to you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our God is good. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Don't let me be the only one up here. Praise Him. Praise the Lord. Praise you, Lord. Press in. Press in for that breakthrough. Praise will get you there. Praise the Lord. After you finish loving on God, let's love on each other.
Center back. about it that way.
Information about our church, our pastors, what we believe, and why we believe it. We have scriptures for it. And on the inside, there's a registration card. Please, please, please fill that out. Drop it in the offering bucket as it goes by, and we just want to be able to greet you a little bit further. Praise the Lord. Well, we got a couple of announcements. Word of Power Bible School. How many of you have attended Word of Power Bible School? Raise your hand. Okay, you know what? If you haven't attended, plan on attending. Sign up on that on the table in the back. We've got a sign-up sheet. You know, Word of Power Bible School is an awesome Bible school. You know, pastors pretty much teach the same thing, but in a different way. You know, every time they've taught the classes, it's grown. It's grown in relation, it's grown in knowledge. And you can't go wrong, even if you've attended it before, if the Lord's talking to you about coming back, come back. Because you know what? You'll get even more out of it. And we are going to be beginning it on the first week in September. The class will be on a Wednesday. So make plans for that. And I also want to put this out there. If for some reason you've attended and you're not able to attend, how about sponsoring a student? You know, if the Lord puts that on your heart, and always sponsor one or two students, whatever the Lord puts on your heart. Amen? Glory to God. And tonight is family night. So there's no evening service tonight. We want to spend time with our families and just be able to relax and have a good time. But we will see you again on Thursday at 7:30. Praise the Lord. And we are declaring we are debt-free. Yeah. And that shall be removed. Yeah. Amen. Pastor Sherry.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to just share on the word concerning giving today. And sometimes you're like, okay, Lord, I'm not real enthused about this because I have to sometimes, you know, discipline and be, you know, reproving, rebuking, and exhorting. But, you know, I just know the people of God aren't takers. We're givers. Amen? And I think sometimes we don't realize that God can only bless us so far. And if I went out to a And I ordered a meal, which we just had one the other day, Hawaiian steak. It was incredible. Longhorn. and they had pineapples on it, and it was sauteed and blackened. And I just said, I need steak. I need steak. I'm getting steak. And so I ordered steak, and it was so good. And it was 11 ounces of pure, delicious, yummy. And so I restrained myself to have a to-go bag because I wanted it again. It was so good, I wanted to eat it two times, you know? And so, but you know, we had an appetizer, we had nice hot bread, we had the steak, and I had this asparagus that was grilled with the steak. Aren't you hungry? And I was so full. I ate Pastor Steve's salad. I mean, I do. I can out-eat him any day. I out-eat him. And I'm also usually the one that cleans up the plate before everybody. And my food's gone, and they're just like starting. I don't know what it is. I love food. Pastor Steve says, honey, you know how many times you say you love food? But you know what? I didn't think about walking out of the restaurant and not paying the bill. You know that? And when we come in the house of God, we need to bring something to the house of the Lord. You know, I was taught, and I'm just going to teach you what I was taught, because it taught me manners in the house of God. You know, you wouldn't dare steal from a restaurant. You wouldn't dare ever walk in, get fed, get blessed, get strengthened, and then not pay the bill. You know, the house of the Lord is way better than a restaurant. We're not a supermarket. We're not a quick and, you know, stop and go or quick hit or get and go. They have those in Tulsa, get and go. And 7-Eleven, we're 24/7. And we pray every day for you guys. And we're in the Word every day. And the lights are on because we are in the Word. And we're here. And you know, if they that preach the gospel shall live of the gospel. And, you know, praise the Lord for the people that are faithful in their tithing giving. Because right last week we had, I'm just going to tell you the truth, last week we were down 30 people. Now we are fine because our tithers who remember that when they go on vacation to send their offering, thank God that got us over the hump. But we had the lowest offering last week ever in the history of our church. And I have to be real with you because this is your house. It's not my house. It's our house. Together. Amen. And the Bible talks about that Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Amen. And so a house, everybody participates. Then, I mean, if it's your house, you don't come in and act like a guest. You come in and you help in the things of the Lord. Isn't that right? Right? Come on. I mean, everybody gets your, okay, she's not jumping on me. I'm just teaching you the Word of God. Woo, get that thing off. Amen. I'm just teaching you proper etiquette, amen? You know, I was taught to give of my tithe and my offering. And, you know, I did it when I went away to college. I still tithe to my local church because I didn't find the local church that I needed to be at. And so I sent my tithe home until I found the church that God wanted me to be for the short season that I was at college. But I still gave the offerings to my home church. And you know, it's like, just because you aren't here doesn't mean that the lights still don't go on and salaries need to be paid. Amen? Amen? And so I guess what I'm saying is, did you notice we need instruments on the platform? You know, thank God for Hearts of Fire. I'm telling you, we have a move of God morning already. But we're believing for musicians. We're believing to not burn the two we have out, and so we need to have some music that's, you know, CD. But that's not the desire of my heart. I want all these seats filled with musicians. And there's been many occasions that we've had the best there. If we don't take care of the house of God, He can't take care of our house. Amen? And I'm not getting hard. I'm just saying, hey, let's give. Let's remember our tithe and our offering, because the church won't go on if the light bill isn't getting paid. Now, we're not going under, praise God, because you know what? We came over here before we knew anyone, and God already started us in full-time ministry, and God's our source. And he always is our source. And he'll move through spectacular means. But you know what? Let's just be faithful with our part. Amen? You know, my daughter has a room. She has to keep her room clean. She has responsibilities. We're children in the house of God. Let's keep up our ministries. If you go away, don't just blow off your ministries. You know, serve and give and bless. And then if you're going on vacation, remind people, hey, get yourself covered. Amen? Because this is God's house. You know, there are more precious transactions that are going on in this building than what's going on in any store around here. I mean, souls are being changed. Lives are being touched. You know, people are getting saved. People are being delivered. We had a testimony just this week. One of the people in this church, you know, they work in a situation, and when they were working, someone had a gun, and they brought it in, and thank God they knew their authority. And that this person came in twice. They let him use the phone once, but then the second time, you know, one of their employees saw that this person had a gun on them, and, you know, thank God our person that was overseeing and managed, you know, you just need to go ahead and leave now. Thank you, but we're not going to have a phone service. And, you know, the Lord is teaching them who they are in Christ. But I said, thank you, Jesus, because we pray every single day that you're walking around and every single day that we're awake, that we pray over our church, no harm, no stealing, no destruction, and no abduction. Amen. And I was like, yes, that's the first thing I thought of when I heard the testimony. The Lord answered our prayer. The Lord answered our prayer because we are called to pray for you. We take our job very seriously. And all we want to do is let's just keep on moving because we're moving up. Are we moving up?
Yeah.
Say it, I'm moving up. I'm moving in the Spirit. I'm going further in God. God is first. He's not second. He's first in my life. Isn't he first? You know, I was, me and Pastor Missy were working on Monday, and I was talking about ministry names. And I had it in my heart. I don't know. You know, it doesn't say Nicholson Ministries on the front of our building. You know, the Lord told us to name our church Faith Family Outreach Church. And when we started this ministry, we prayed about everything. We prayed about what the name is. We prayed about what the calling is. You know, the Lord appeared to me in a vision and shared some of the mandate and the calling that we have on our lives. But the first thing he said is the first thing is faith. Your faith is first. God is first in our life. And then second comes our family. Amen? Isn't that right? I mean, I praise God, but the Lord didn't just, you know, I didn't have a family until God gave me a family. I was in God before I was in the family.
Amen.
And so were you.
Amen.
Amen? And so our family isn't first. It's God who's first. Our church faith and then family, because second is family. And we believe in the family. We believe in building up the family. Amen? And we're a family in God. And a lot of us come in and we don't know how to act in the house of God. I didn't know how to act in the house of God. I had to be trained. And so, boy, it's cold in here now. It seems like almost like a rebuke. It's not a rebuke. God says that his house is a house of prayer. And you know, one of the things I love about Father God is you can go in his refrigerator anytime. He has plenty of everything that we need. Amen? And I don't know about you, but I'm believing for some debt to be out of my life. How about you? Well, I want to align my life so that he will come in like a freight train and remove all the debt. And if there's obstacles, it's not on his end, it's on my end. Amen? And so sometimes, you know, I don't know if you, I've seen weeds in my nice flower beds, and I didn't plant those stupid old weeds. Right? But we have to get around. We've got to manicure our flower beds, and we got to pull those weeds out that try to come in and choke the goodness of the plant. Isn't that right? And so that's all we're doing today is we're just pulling out some weeds, and we're teaching us that we are in the house of God and that he wants us to put him first. And you guys do. And we thank you for being a faithful tither. You know, thank God, because we're going into all the world and we're preaching the gospel and we're getting books, you know, translated in the Croatian language. And Randy stepped into China to, you know, yesterday, supporting that. We're excited about the things that God is doing all around the world, and he's using us. And we've trained four Bible schools just in this city, Bible classes, Bible graduates, and we've trained a lot in Lakeland, and they're going all around the world, and it's not stopping. We're just getting more increasing and abounding. We're increasing and abounding. Are you increasing and abounding? I'm increasing and abounding. I'm not thinking just community. I'm thinking the world. I'm thinking the world. God's moving us into the world in a greater way. And if he's moving us, he's moving you, because we're in the house. We're in the family. Amen? And so if you need an offering envelope, you can lift your hand. Praise the Lord. Don't we get excited that we get to give? I'm excited I get to give. I've been waiting all week to give. I'm excited to give because I'm looking for a harvest. I'm believing for a big harvest. God's a good God. And he says, whatever we plant, we'll reap. Whatever we sow, right, we'll get back. We'll get back in so many, he said, in a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall even men come and give it to our bosom. And so we may not know how he's going to get it to us, but we know he's going to get it to us. And one of the ways we know is he's going to move in promotions. He's going to move in things that we have not seen yet. But I sense, we got it last night in prayer, that there's a greater flow and promotions coming in 6 weeks, 6 months. What was it, 6 weeks?
6 months.
6 months. Thank you, Pastor James. I thought it was. And the Lord's going to do some changing. He's going to do some rearranging. He's bringing us into a higher flow and a higher level. And I'm receiving that. Praise the Lord. Amen. How about you?
Yes.
Psalm 23 says, surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. How about you? He's following us. Amen? And it says, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. We're going to live in the house of the Lord forever and ever. I don't want to live in someone else's. I want to live in God's house. How about you? I'm glad my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we want others to be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You know what? It's good just to know the Lord. Isn't it good? He's a good God. And Pastor Sherry loves me. Some of you said it. How about all of us saying it? Pastor Sherry, yes, I love you. And you know what? I'm so glad I didn't write these words. Jesus wrote them. I just want to remind you, my name is not in here anywhere in this book. Not one place is Sherry Nicholson in here. I didn't write any of it. And so don't shoot the messenger, amen? I'm just one messenger telling another messenger where we found the word of love and the word of life. And you know what? Thank God. Thank God for the Word. Thank God for the Word. I would not be around without the Word of God in my life. I would not be where I am. I would not be prosperous without standing on the Word. And I don't argue about the Word. I believe the Word. The Word says it. I believe it. And it settles it. I don't have to feel it. I don't have to touch it or taste it. The Word says it. And I said, okay, I'm going to give because it says to give. And as I did, and I didn't hardly have anything in the beginning, but bless God, we got a lot now. I was just thanking the Lord the other day. I was like, praise the Lord. You know, we have this hot water heater that's on its very, very last leg. And Yazzie's going, boy, this hot water, but don't speak negative of our hot water heater. Thank God it's still working. Thank God it's still working. It's like 20 years old. It's a miracle. Now, you be good, hot water heater. I'm talking about you. Don't you act up while I'm talking about you. You're going to keep giving me hot water, praise the Lord. Amen? And it's like, yeah, he goes, why don't we just buy another one? I'm like, well, it's still working. Why waste your money if it's still working? It's like, yes, you don't understand. That's a lot of money. And we pay cash for stuff around this house. We're not going into credit. And I remember when I just started coming to the Lord, and Pastor Steve and I hardly had two nickels to rub together, but we tithed and we gave offerings. I remember the first time I got to buy a washing machine with cash. Boy, I thought I hit the lotto twice over. I'm like, woo, I get to buy a washing machine. And I began to think about how long ago that was and what the Lord, you know, we're not that old. And I was like, thank you, Lord, I got to pay cash for that. It was my first Bible school check I ever made, and I put it toward a new, brand new washing machine. And then I started thinking about, well, look at what the Lord has done. I've got a brand new washing machine twice over again, a brand new dryer, a brand new refrigerator. We just got blessed with a recliner. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And you know what? Every single one of those was with cash. I don't have a credit debt on my furniture. God is a good God. And look what he's done. How come? Because I was a giver. Because I just practiced the principles of God's word. Amen. Did you get something today? Amen. I love you. Let's lift up our offerings. They're to the Lord. Amen. The tithe belongs to the Lord. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be a giver. We thank you that we already know this. We are doers of the word. And those that don't know, they're learning and they are making adjustments. We thank you. We pray that the eyes of their understanding would be flooded with light, that they understand what the tithe is. Bless the gift, the giver, pressed down, shaken together, and running over in Jesus' name. And I do say this, that we are the head and not the tail. We're not going under. We're not going under because you won't let us go under. And we declare that over our finances in this church and in our people in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Say, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
Woo! We could shout. Hallelujah! Glory to God.
Praise the Lord again. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm trading my shame. I'm
God. Praise the Amen. We rejoice in you, Lord. Lord, we trade all those things for your joy. Lord, we will rejoice in you. This is the day you have made. And we will rejoice and be glad in it. We take our will and we make it rejoice. Lord, no matter what it looks like, you are the champion. And we have victory in your name. Hallelujah. Give them praise. Amen. Give them praise. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Master of creation. We praise you, Master of all creation. Amen. Shout glory. Amen. Slap somebody high five and you may be squeeded. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. It's a done deal. Yes. You act like it, you talk like it, you praise the Lord like it. Amen. Yes. And that's how you overcome. Yes. This is how we overcome. Amen. Yes. Yep, run like it, talk like it, yes, praise like it, shout like it. Yes. Amen. Yes. Act as if it's already done. Faith acts. Yes. Faith acts. It doesn't wait. Faith, yes, doesn't hesitate and, yes, wait. Faith acts. Yeah. Amen? Amen? And praise the Lord, we've been talking about faith. We've been talking about having faith in the unseen realm. Amen? Amen. But let's just pray for a minute in the Spirit, because there's something I have, you know, in the Spirit to do here. So let's pray. Zaranda kinched global praseya. Rana makambra. Pastor Miss, come up here, please. I got a word from you.
Mike.
Are we gonna have an usher, or do you want her to break her butt? Thank you. I'm not being mean, but I know we get in the spirit in this church, but let's remember we have things to do also. The word of the Lord to you is that you have become, not going to be, you have become a great intercessor in my kingdom. Not only do you preach well, but you pray well. And the Lord says, when those that come to me can pray well and preach well, great things happen in the spirit. And the Lord says, you have prayed through some mighty burdens. You have prayed through some mighty things that you know not even of yet. You will see them in the days to come. You will see them in eternity. The Lord says, many souls and many people have been touched and delivered by your prayers. There are many in this church that don't even realize they wouldn't be here if it had not been for your intercession and your prayers. You have prayed for us as pastors with all of your heart and with all of your soul and all your mind. And sometimes without you and Pastor James, we would have not been able to stand and make it through. So every bit of credit that we get in this ministry for what we've done also goes to you and Pastor James. For you have been faithful to the call. And the Lord says, I will bring you up into a place where there will be no confusion, but it'll clear. Everything will become clear in your mind and thinking. And all you want to do is start drinking. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Thank you, ushers. Let's see if we got somebody else. Glory ball. Sometimes, Lord says, it seems like you make three steps or four steps forward, and then all of a sudden the devil's trying to knock you off your feet. But the Lord says, you cannot be defeated, and you shall not fail. For you are a warrior. You are a prayer warrior. You are a mighty woman and man of God. And you have the support that you need, sister. You have the strength within you. And you have the strength without you, too. So just draw off of what's in you. Draw off of what's without you. Draw off of anything you need. It's yours. I'm supplying it. And you are victorious. You are healed. You are delivered.
Yes.
You are joyful and triumphant,
yes,
says the Lord. You're my victory. You're my token of glory. You're my champion. And that's the way you are. And that's what I say, and that's what I see. And the Lord says, and it's so. because you know it so down in your spirit. You know that I love you with an undying, everlasting love, and that my complete desire for you is complete wholeness. And for you too, brother, that you be strengthened by his spirit in your inner man. That Christ would rise up in you and refresh you and strengthen you with faith in the inner man, with the reinforcement of the power of God in you and Jesus. Thank you for it, Lord. Amen. Praise God. You know what Brother Hagin says? If you need that, take it. I mean, it's specific for someone you're praying for, but if you need it yourself, receive it. Draw, take that. Just lift your hands right now and say, I take that, Lord. Say, strengthen me, Lord. Build me up right now, Lord. Fill me with your glory. I thank you, Lord. I am in the overflow in every area of my life. I'm in the victory. I'm in the power. And the power is in me. And the love of God overcomes all in my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Bless your name. Bless your name. Bless your name forever. Amen. Bless his name. Thank you. Bless your name, Lord. Bless your name. Bless your holy name forever. Bless your name. Your name is awesome. Your name is mighty. Praise the Lord. It's majestic and glorious and worthy to be praised. Praise God. Well, I want to continue on with having faith in the unseen realm. Amen. And last week we talked 4 points about how to keep your faith strong. We taught that if you want to keep your faith strong, put the Word of God first in your life. Focus on the Word first in your life. And then secondly, believe and trust the Word over everything, you see. Then third was praise God. You know, or the third was refuse to consider the contradictory circumstances in your life. And then the fourth was praise God for the answer. Because we're talking about we don't have to beg God after he heard us the first time. And if we praise him and keep thanking him and affirming what he has already promised us, then the Lord, it's like sitting in his face all the time. And you know, it's like a faith confession all the time, because praise is a confession of faith. Praise is the language of faith. And so you're constantly praising him. I thank you, Lord, that need is met in my life. I thank you that my family's healed. I thank you that that sister's restored from depression. I thank you that I'm delivered from whatever addiction or I thank you, Lord, that by his stripes I am healed. I praise you for your word. I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed. And you keep praising him. And no matter how long it may take to manifest, you know that God said it, and it's so, and you believe it in your life, and then it will come to pass. Amen? You know what I love? It says in Mark 11:23, it says, whosoever says unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in here, but believe those things which he saith shall come to pass. He'll have whatsoever he saith. And so praising is like saying it. Praise is like saying it's come to pass when you're already thanking him for something. And you know, what I like is it says it will come to pass. It didn't come to stay. Whatever circumstance, whatever mountain is in your life, maybe depression, maybe fear, it's not coming to stay. When you speak unto it, it has to go. Because the Lord said so. And that's all I need. Amen. Look here in the Word, if you would, to... First, just let me read this to you. It's in Isaiah. And it says, who measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and made and meted out the heavens with a span? I like that. It's a psalm. It says, who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and who have meted out the heavens with a span? And comprehended the dust of the earth in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales, and the hills in a balance. The works of the Lord are great, sought out of all men that have pleasure therein. What I love about this is it says, who hath measured the waters in the hollow of his hand? You know, the hollow of your hand is right here. So if you close your hand, you have a measure of something in your hand. Now, normally our hand, probably the water would leak out. But the Lord can hold it right there. And it says he's taken, you know, the average span of a human hand is 9 inches. And he's taken that hollow in his hand, and he has scaled the whole oceans, rivers, lakes, waters by that. In other words, by that measure, he's measured it up. How many, you know, quadruples or millions of times. He knows the exact weight. He knows the exact amount. He knows it to the last drop.
Amen.
Just like, what's that coffee? Good to the last drop. He knows it's good to the last drop because he made it. He said it was good. But anyway, so what I like is, you know, he took that and he measured it. And then it says, and he meted out the heavens with a span. In other words, he spanned the heavens, the scale of everything that was going to be, and it was measured out by the measure of its hand. Say you had a hand 9 inches, and you measured it all out. Okay, this is all the space in infinity. And so you can't even put time on it, but there is a measure. And God, of course, can expand his hand to be around the whole universes and the university of universes and whatever else that he's created. And he contains the universe. They don't contain him, even though he lives in them. He is the one that contains them. He can fold them all up if he wants. And so it says, and he comprehended the dust of the earth. Woo! In other words, he took one piece of dust. He said, because it says he comprehended the dust of the earth by measure. And he took one piece of dust, and he scaled all the mountains and everything that was in them with one piece of dust. He said, this is how many pieces of dust there are. And he named off the amount and the number, the weight, everything. See, everything that God ever did, and the Lord was really showing me this when he created this, is that he executed it to perfection, and there's nothing lost to his sight. There's not one particle of your body that's missing from his sight. Not one particle of his plan for you. He has it all set up ahead of time. He knows the beginning from the end, and the end is you win. And the middle is you triumph all the way through in Christ Jesus your Lord. Amen. And so he does all this, and he measures all this, and he creates us, and there is not one particle, one atom missing from our body. So if the devil comes and tries to change and rearrange the image we have of ourselves, and we start speaking that over ourselves, then sometimes our bodies will change to obey it. Sometimes our monies will change to obey it, because we take what's eternal and powerful, and we start to transform it the opposite way, and circumstances abide by our words. Amen. That's why he said words were so important. because everything that he did was created by words. And they are faith-filled words. Amen? And so, I like this story. There was a girl who had a eye disease, and she was probably in her teens, and she was about 14, I think, and her eye disease, she lost her sight completely with this eye disease, and she had been blind for 3 years, but she knew what the Word of God said already, because their parents had discipled her in faith and all. And so she started confessing the Word over her eyes every day. In about a year and a half, she heard the Word of the Lord speak to her directly, and he said, "In springtime, you will see again." That's a definite word from the Lord. When you get a word like that, bless God, take a hold of it and put your hooks in it and root it in your spirit. And be convicted that it's coming to pass, not coming to stay. Because your mouth's saying it, and you're believing it, and God said it, and it's in your heart. And she took that, and about a month and a half later, it was still going to be about 4 months till spring. She just got up one day, and she was blind, and she couldn't see, and she said, "Father, could it just be spring today?" And he said, "Yes." And her eyes popped open.
Praise God.
In other words, "I don't want to wait anymore. Father, would you make it spring today?" That's our Father. And he wants everything in us perfection. He sees us prosperous. He sees us blessed. He sees everything in us the way that he made us to be. Amen?
Yes.
Praise God. We're his works. Amen?
Yes.
And he spoke his word over us, and he wrote our name in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And he gave us authority and power. He gave us our dominion back over the devil, disease, sickness, death, and all its cohorts, demons, everything. Amen? So there are laws that we can put in action through our confession. Let's bow our heads. Father, I just thank you right now for the word of the Lord. Thank you for the word of the Lord is powerful. It is mighty amongst nations. And Lord, let our praise spring forth and honor for your word today. And we come reverentially, Lord, and we thank you for the great Spirit who has created all things through you and your word, that he will manifest and teach us, that we might know you, Lord, and the hope of your calling in our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, praise the Lord. I want to talk today about tapping into the spirit realm with your faith. So, if you could, look over here at Hebrews 11:1 with me. Somebody hit their keys accidentally. There we go. Wow. Oh, thank you, brother.
Making an announcement, the black Mercedes. Dude with the black Mercedes.
What? Oh, okay. Hallelujah. Now, verse 1 of Hebrews 11. Are you there? No? Sure. Let me know when you get there. Hebrews 11:1. Okay?
Yes.
All right. It says here now, faith. Say faith.
Faith.
Is the assurance.
Is the assurance.
The substance.
Substance.
Of things hoped for.
Things hoped for.
And it's the conviction. Or evidence. Of things not seen. And then say this with me, verse 3. By faith,
we understand
that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of all things which are visible. And now it goes on to tell about people that walked in faith. It talks about Abel. His sacrifice was a sacrifice of faith, so it spoke to God even after he died. His blood spoke to God that he was a man of God. It talks about, by faith, verse 5, Enoch was taken up, that he should not see death, and was not found because God took him up and obtained the witness that before taking him, he was pleasing to God. So we see here that Enoch was so full of faith that God, and it was Old Testament, he was so full of faith that God just said one day, as he was walking with them for about 300 years, because when Enoch had his 65, he had his first child. And it says he didn't really pay much. Something about having that child, the miracle of childbirth. And from that on time, it said for the next 300 years, he walked with God. And one day he was just walking, and he just stepped right up off the earth, and God took him. Elijah went that way. Amen. And when we think about that, that is a representation and type of now us being translated from death to life. Because what's happened here is we were dead spiritually, but God, he took us up to heaven. He took us to the cross. And he washed every sin and all the sickness and disease and poverty and hate and all that. He cleansed us of that. He became our substitute, which is what faith is, the substance. Faith is the substitute of things hoped for and the evidence of things you can't see. So what happened is Jesus is the Word, and faith is the substitute. What's that mean? It's the substitute. Jesus paid the price. He made a promise. He made a bond in his covenant blood. And he said, I'm becoming their substitute right now for sickness and disease. I'm becoming their substance for depression and fear and hate and emotionalism and every evil thing that can hurt them, every curse of the law. Because he became a curse for us in order that in Christ the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles, so we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Yeah. It's by faith. Say, by faith. And faith believes the Word. Yeah. And it's the substance of things hoped for. So in that Word, when you receive when you confess with your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord, it says in Romans 10, 9 and 10, and believe in your heart that God hath raised him to the dead, he not only paid for all your sins and took you to the cross by him, sees you already crucified with Christ, but then he took you up to heaven with him by presenting his blood. Before you were ever even born, that blood went up to heaven and the whole church was resurrected with Christ.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Because the Bible says in Ephesians, it talks about, now we are seated together with him in heavenly places in Christ.
Amen.
In other words, we have the same heirship, the same righteousness, the same faith, the same dominion. We're joint heirs with Jesus. It says if he was justified, in the end of Romans 8, 32 on, if we were justified with him, if he was justified, we were justified with him. And if we were made righteous, and we were also glorified with him. So you are glorified. Say, I'm a glorified being. Say, I'm a glorified being. Glory be. Glory be. That, I know, that was bad. But you can go through the whole book here of Hebrews 11, and you can see each person's faith. You know, they're looking for something that you can't touch with your hands. They're believing in the things that cannot be seen. So faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hope is a good waiter. It helps you. It, you know, without hope, you wouldn't have any faith. Hope is what keeps you alive. You keep hoping that the promises of God are true. You start out hoping. And then it comes to the time where you've been believing, you know, and confessing, and you're hoping, and then all of a sudden your hope turns to faith. And what happens is instead of you just having that, you ever had that feeling of I just a dreaming, oh, I could see myself doing that someday. I have a dream about doing something. And at first it's just a dream. And it's almost like it's unreal, it's a fantasy. But hope is not a fantasy.
Amen.
Hope is belief in a person. And his word, and that's Jesus. And it's an expectancy for that person to do what he said. And all of a sudden it'll move over into faith when you keep filling yourself up with hope. And those two together with love coupled, they will cause anything manifest in the universe that is needed for God to do, to move. And what happens is there's an unseen realm which was here before any creation was here in the material realm. It's more real than anything we can see, feel, touch, or smell. Because faith also is a substance of not seen. It means Hebrews 11:1 in the Amplified says, faith perceives as real fact that which is not revealed to the senses.
Amen.
Means you can know and hear that you've got faith for something. It's just a knowing. The Bible says in 1 John 2:20, it says we have an unction from the Holy One and we know all things. What does it mean? We know all things that we need to know as we're meditating in the Word of God. We begin to get bits and pieces of revelation. And that's the rhema of the Word. And when you all of a sudden, you know, you ever been reading the Word and something pops off the page and the Holy Ghost just makes it clear. And he gives you something on it, like a revelation on this scripture really means. That's when you know it's not just the general word. That's when you have a specific word that becomes substance in your spirit. It becomes the DNA of God, becomes alive in you. Just like our sister here is pregnant and she looks like she's about to have that child. How many months are you now? 5 weeks left. And she wants to come sooner. Well, I don't blame you. I don't blame you. But, really? Well, praise the Lord. Mark wanted to have it today, huh? In the church. Well, really seeing born again. Why not? It's church. We're born again. Oh, man. Rebirth, yeah. Or first birth, whatever. Amen. New birth. What? Okay. Well, praise God. What I'm trying to say is that, like, Brother Cho taught it like this, and Brother Cho has got a church of over 1 million people. I mean, he's an amazing guy. I've got some of his tapes. But anyway, he was talking about how when he first got a hold of faith, he was dying of a fatal disease. He was a Buddhist. Everything he could to believe he was healed of that disease, and nothing happened. He meditated on all this, you know, spirit. See, because his own spirit couldn't heal him without the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is the healer.
Yes, Lord.
He's come. He's the agent of God that has been sent to the earth to heal, to make life abundantly, and the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from disease and from all the evil. The world cannot exact itself. Satan cannot exact himself upon the believer because we walk in a bubble of protection. And so the Spirit of God, when it's deposited in us, it rises up. And so it was like Brother Cho began to see that in his life. And he said he felt like he was pregnant because he started to meditate on the Word. And as he meditated, that Word got into him. And the more he meditated, the more he realized, this isn't just any old words. This is a life. This is life-giving. This is the light of God. The light pierces darkness. Amen. He causes life to come. And where that sickness was, life came into his body, and he was miraculously healed by the power of God. And he was pregnant with that until it came to pass, until he birthed that revelation into his body. Same thing with us. You know, he said he needed to believe God for a bike for his first church and a desk. And he said he did the same way. Confessed the word, believed it, and he was pregnant with it. And people would come up to him and say, where's your bike? You know, because they knew he needed a bike. And where he lives in Seoul, Korea, that bikes are a big thing because they don't want to get cars as much because they block you from getting where you need to go. And they'd say, where's your bike? And he says, oh, I have it. Don't you see it? It's beautiful. It's beautiful red bike with a 10-gear shifter on it. It's a very expensive one, too. And it's easy to ride on. And they would come up to him and they'd go, you're crazy. That's what people will tell you when you're faith people. So, I mean, you don't have to tell everybody everything about, you know, what you're believing for. But anyway, and so finally, all of a sudden, he had a bike. And then he believed God for a big desk for an office so that he could have a place where he had a church. And all of a sudden, you know, they were saying, where's your big desk? He said, well, I'm getting that where my bike came from God. He said he was pregnant with a big desk. What does that mean? It means you're pregnant in here in the supernatural world. You've spoken it, God's heard it, and he is causing it to come into substance and coming to being. Faith is that substance that's creative. It's a creative power. And that's why we can have body parts recreated. And things can be recreated that the devil stole from us. We can be restored sevenfold from whatever Satan has tried to steal out of our lives. Amen. Let's go back and walk into the enemy's camp and take back by faith what's been stolen from you. Amen. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Look over here with me to 2 Corinthians. What's the inside joke here? Praise the Lord. Are you in 2 Corinthians chapter 3? Yeah. Praise the Lord. Look at verse 17. Okay? 2 Corinthians 3:17. It says here, now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Say it again. There is liberty. Say liberty. Oh, Mr. Liberty.
Mr. Liberty.
And so, in other words, when the supernatural comes in contact with the natural, it liberates us from Satan, from bad thinking, from materialism, all those things. They have to obey what the Spirit of the Lord is. There's no condemnation to those in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit has set us free. Did you hear me? I said set us free.
Yes.
Hallelujah. When you're free, you're liberated.
Yes.
Set us free from the law of sin and death. That means death and sin have no power over us. We have power over that.
Amen.
It says here in Hosea 13, Jesus said, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, where is your plague? O grave, where is your destruction?
Yes.
He was saying, you have no destruction. You cannot put any plague on me. And then it says later over in 2 Corinthians 15, it says, death has lost its sting.
Yes.
Because the great robber came.
Yes.
And he took hell out of us. And he robbed the grave before Satan could get us. Now death has no sting over us. And anything to do with death can't sting us. Disease, anything.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord. Look here with me at verse 16, not Vorsey. Verse 16. Look at 15. That's even better. It says, for all things are for your sakes, that grace, it's God's riches at Christ's expense. He paid all the payments so that we would be debt free in life. Verse 15, 2 Corinthians 4:15. I'm sorry. 4:15. Yes, I'm sorry. For all things are for your sakes. Notice that all things are for your sake. That grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. He paid all the debts, everything, so that for our sakes we might have all things from God. And having spread through to the many may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God.
Amen.
Means when all the blessings of God are spread around, everybody gets to praising them. Everybody gets to shout and thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. That's what real Pentecost is. It's people that aren't afraid to lift their hands and shout hallelujah around the throne of God. Amen. A lot of people that are read back about Christ here and all that, they're going to be real surprised when they get to heaven. People are going to go fanatical over that. And they're going to go crazy when they see him, but in the right way. Their mind will be removed, and they'll have the mind of God. Amen? Remember Jesse Duplantis telling a story about how he said that when he got up into heaven, he was just, you know, walking. It was beautiful. He said he'd step on flowers, and he said when he walked by, they were alive. And he said they would come straight back up after he stepped on them because they can't die. You can't. They'd come right back up, and he said it was almost like they were smiling at him because the life of God was just pumping through them, and they were like, he said, I could feel the love of God coming out of those flowers. He said, I could feel the love of God coming out of the grass, out of the trees, out of the mountains. He said it was everywhere in heaven. The light of his love was everywhere. It shined up all about heaven. And then he said he came to this place where this family was picnic. And he said, and they invited him to sit down and have a picnic. So we still eat, I guess. Thank God. We're going to have us a feast when we get there. It says that when we go there for a 7-year feast, when we get out of here, they'll be down here on the earth, but we'll be out of here. And Chuck will be the hamburger cooker there. It'll be better than SpongeBob burgers. Sorry. You're laughing because you all watched it. No, I know you haven't. But anyway, but everything was just smiling at him, he said, and then this family, they sat down and they ate this food. And he said, they got so happy. They were just, because the presence of the Lord was so strong, that they were so thankful for their meal and thankful for their fellowship, that they were speaking a blessing and they got the joy of the Lord hit them. And he said, they all got up and they were screaming praises to the Lord. The whole family was, hallelujah, Jesus, we love you. Wah! And they said, the next thing that happened was, it was like the wine of the Spirit hit everybody right there. And it was just, he said, it was indescribable, the liberty and joy and the freedom. And he said, we had to do everything we could to just pull back and stop praising. And stop, because we had other things to do. And he was talking about the fact that Jesus, another guy said, but when Jesus was in the river of life, he was dunking him there. A Robert, 10-year-old boy, went up to heaven. He was dunking. Jesus was dunking him in the river of life. And he said, every time he'd dunk him under, he'd get drunk in the Spirit. And he didn't know what that meant at the time. All he knows is he was laughing, and he just couldn't control it. And Jesus would start laughing with him. And he said, and he pulled him up one time, and he said, Jesus got so out of control with laughter. He said that all heaven, it spread across all heaven, and everybody was laughing. Everybody. And he said, Jesus, he saw his eyes squint to fight to stop laughing. Because he had other things to do, but man, he knows how to have a good time. And we think, you know, that we think the material realm's all right. The material realm ain't nothing. That which created all this is awesome. Amen. And so, we need to understand that faith is of the spirit world. It operates in a place that we can't see with our natural eyes, but with our supernatural eyes. And then it says here in verse 17, it says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. In other words, when you're walking in God, the afflictions are light. If you're walking in yourself and your flesh, the afflictions are hard.
Amen.
But the Lord said, when you stay meditated up on my word and filled up with me, he said, and your mind stays renewed. You see, when we get born again, he didn't save our mind or our body. He saved our spirit.
Yes.
And he says, we need to, in 1 Corinthians 9:27, we put on body and bring it into subjection, lest after we preach to others, Paul said, you know, we be castaways. It means we be thrown out of the will of God. And so he said, I put under my body and bring it into subjection, lest after I have preached to others, I will be a castaway. He was saying, I as the man on the inside, I my spirit puts under my body, and lest it gets control of him. And that's what we do with our minds, too. We renew our minds through the Word so that everything begins to line up and yield to the Spirit of God.
Amen.
And then what happens is, when we're walking in that realm, those afflictions just go off us like water off a duck's back. We're just like, we shake them off. And we say, no, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The other day, I was sitting at my study desk, and cares started to come on me about a particular situation. And I had already confessed and prayed, but they were, you know, the thoughts. I said, this is the only realm Satan works.
Right.
He can't work, and he can't do anything else, but if we let him, he will make a nest in our thinking, and then he'll try to continue to bombard those thoughts until they get down and they are like a stronghold, and it's like you're in bondage. But he can make a nest sometimes there, but I like what Brother Higgins said, thoughts that don't get put into words die unborn.
Amen.
That's why death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those that love it eat the fruit of it. If we won't speak death, then those thoughts will go. If we won't speak the thoughts, but we'll speak the word in place of the thoughts,
yes.
Then they got to go.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 3, 5, 4, and 5 says that the weapons of our warfare aren't carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Those strongholds in our mind of past things. Pulling down a strong, casting down imaginations. In other words, wicked things that would try to come to our thinking. Casting them down and bringing them into obedience to the anointing of Christ. It means you can pull them in and say, you obey me, thoughts. The anointing of the Word of God is greater than you, and I pull you into obedience, and you stay under me. You stay under my feet. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. I'm sorry. And so, where was I? I was talking about putting under my body. I was talking about the Spirit and casting the care. And so the enemy was really bombarding me. And this is what you need to do sometimes. Don't do this. Don't say, Satan, get off of me. And then, you know, I've done it before. You know, as a matter of fact, I've done it probably way too many times. But as I'm starting to grow up, I don't have time for that garbage. I don't have time for it, to pity myself. Which, believe me, that was my number one problem. Because my mother grew up, you know, always depressed and all that. And so it was on me, you know. And so I was like that way. But so this is coming about the situation, the pressure, and along with that's coming that self-pity. And I finally said, you don't just say goodbye and, you know, you leave, say. I said, Satan, get off of my mind. I take charge over you in Jesus' name, and I am your master. And I command you to get off my thinking. You have no place in my mind. I am anointed by the Spirit of God. And I'm telling you, just as soon as I got my fingers, those thoughts were gone. And sometimes that's the way you got to cast your care on the devil. You got to get violent with them. Smith Wigglesworth once said he was at a bus stop, and he was with a lady who had a little dog with him. And he said, the pooch was right there, and, you know, she was going, oh, Annie Schmiggy, and I don't know, you know, you're going to have to go home and find out. The bus pulled up, and she looked at, you know, the dog, and the dog was like trying to follow her on the bus. And she said, no, you got to go home. And finally she said, get back home. And she stomped her foot and said, get out. Get back home. And of course that dog turned his tail and went, pfft. Wigglesworth said, that's how you do the devil. Don't tolerate a second of his crap. We don't need to tolerate him. And no matter what we're going through, and I know it can be rough. I know maybe your body's hurting right now. Maybe your mind has been attacked this week. Maybe you're physically just fighting being, you know, worn out or all these things, you know, or in some situation financially. But the good news is that your faith overrides it. And that's what I want you to get is it's just a light affliction. And we're going to close with this scripture, okay? Just stay right there where you are in Corinthians. It says, for we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. Say the things which are not seen. It says, for the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are what? So in other words, what he's saying is, don't look at the circumstances or Satan or whatever the situation is, but look at the realm of God. Look at the spiritual realm. Look at the present tense light of the revelation of God. Keep your focus on the Word. Keep our minds on the Word. Amen? And hang in there. Sometimes it doesn't end in 2 seconds. But, you know, we need to know that we have faith to overcome every situation. But we have to believe the unseen. Yeah. Amen. And we are created in the image of God. And so you are special. And you are precious to God. Everything, every fiber of your being was woven, it says in Psalm 139, it was woven as a fabulous mystery before you were even born. Every part. And this is what I learned as I'm closing. I had no revelation of that whatsoever when I was growing up. And I abused the tar on my body. I thought my body was just there to be filled with pleasure. And, you know, I knew I had a spirit and I still, you know, tried to treat people well. But I had so much disrespect for my temple. I drank constantly and I partied all the time. Anything they were partying with, I'd party. And sometimes wouldn't eat because I'd just be drinking, you know, for days in a row and just wouldn't hardly eat anything. I got to the place where right at the end, before I finally came back to the Lord the last time, I was drinking a quart and a half of rum every day. And that had me going on for about 4 or 5 months. I was drunk all the time. But it got to the place like I wasn't drunk because I just steadily stayed drunk. And when I came to the Lord, I needed a major deliverance. And I came into the church that I knew, you know, the people loved me in. And I walked down the aisle to get my heart right with the Lord. Repented, you know, was no feeling there or anything because I had, you know, done everything I could to destroy what God had done in my life. But in spite of that, I repented and I just trusted God. Even though I didn't understand how much God loved me at the time, and I still don't, I'll never know how much, because it says for eons of time, he's going to reveal his love and kindness to us. That means when we're over in eternity, there'll never be a moment of existence where God won't be showing you his love more and more and more. And so, I took it by faith, but you know, my body was so messed up that I couldn't even have a proper bowel movement for over 3 months. I mean, just nothing came out right. And I thought my stomach was gone. I thought my body was pretty much shot and I was just riding on the edge of life. But I was on the edge of life, a different kind. And God restored me, and he healed me, and he delivered me from my emotional and replaced it with love and strength and peace. And sometimes even to this day, I still have to deal with my body. I still have to say to things that are trying to get on it, no, I'm not accepting you. But I know the outcome is that I will get through this like I have all the other hundreds and thousands of trials that have been in my life, and I'll come out on the other side, the champion. And Lord, the word, and he gave this word to some people in here right now. Some people that are in their 50s. Maybe middle, maybe beginning, maybe late 50s, maybe even early 60s. The Lord says to some of you have been suffering physical pain in your 50s. He said, I give you a promise that will all be done away with when you turn 60. It'll all be done away with long before that. He told me that last night. And he told me to give it to the people in the church, that this is just a test. And he said after that period of time, And as we have been standing, he said, you'll be stronger than you've ever been. You'll feel younger than you've ever felt. And you'll be able to live with zeal and power and finish your life with the last years of your life, the best years of your life. And your leaves will not wither. Your fruit will be great, and nothing that you have put your hand to will fade, but it shall produce until the day that you come home. That's what the Spirit of the Lord says. If you need that, I need that. Take it. Amen. Take it right now. Say, I take that by faith. I believe it's done. Jesus' name. Maybe you'll be one of those, the Lord says, it'll say, can it be 60 now? Or if you're already in your 60s, you say, I'm already 60, Lord. I'm back. Amen. Love you guys. Let's bow our heads. Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to be here to serve your people. It's an honor. I wouldn't trade it for all the money in the world or anything that could possibly come our way, because, Lord, I found that the will of God and the way of God is always best. And if we are willing and obedient, we will always be blessed. So I just thank you. I just pray your perfect will in every person's life here, that you would help them walk by faith and not by sight, and that you will cause them to walk in the light. I pray that your divine smile will shine down upon everyone in this place, and that they will know that you are giving them your love and grace. And you're smiling on them, and you're proud of them, and you believe in them, even when they don't believe in themselves. And that there's no way they can fail, because they're your children. They're not in themselves, but they're in you. If there's anyone that would say, I just really need a touch from God right now, either physically, emotionally, any area like that, you're being attacked, or emotions or your physical body needs to be healed, lift your hand right now. Hey, God bless you. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Why don't you come up here and we're going to pray for you. If we could line up right kind of right about right there, start. Over there, please. Thank you. Kind of like the line. Yeah, right there. Great. Move over a little, please, brother. About a foot apart. God. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You don't have to tell me what it is, but if you want to, you can. Pardon? Oh, thank you. just thank you. I just cast every hindrance, every stronghold, go from this mind right now. Your attack, Satan, be gone. I pray there be supernatural restoration in the in this chemical balance in her thinking and her mind and every part of her, Lord. Balance it out, Lord. You're the one that holds the scales and balances in your hands, you said. So balance this out now. In Jesus' name we pray and heal her. Amen. Amen. Girl. Any prayer over this? Or? Okay. Okay. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, for this attack on his thinking, I just bind you. I cast you off, stronghold. We tear you out from the roots. Be gone from him now, in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you for healing in his body. Lord, his blood will be normal. Blood pressure, go down, be normal. I speak to you. We tell you, we set where you are, and we tell you, we set you at normal. And the blood sugar levels, we pray, come up and be normal. This blood sugar, you, the law of the life, of the spirit of life, the blood of Christ, work and do a miracle in his blood. And I praise you for it in Jesus' name. You spirit of infirmity, yes. I curse your power. Loose her mind right now. Spirits of try to come and bring this mind trouble and hindrance. We just bind you up. We cast you off her mind right now. You troubles, you hell spirits. Lord, I just pray you lying devils go now. And I thank you for peace that mounts garrison guard around her heart and mind in Christ Jesus, Lord, that she'll have great peace and that there will be no problems, but you will keep her in your peace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Gabriel. Father, I just thank you right now for my brother, Lord. I thank you that you are doing a great work in him. You're working in his mind, you're working in his heart, working in every area of his life. And I speak also to the emotions that they would be stable and still. I curse this attack on his thinking. You unstable devils, you spirits that harass his mind. Go! Now I pray there be peace over my brother from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. You cause everything that he needs to be worked out, Christ. Show him what he needs to do, Lord, to help it work. But you do it, Lord. We believe you're doing it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. I just thank you for my brother. Thank you, Lord, that you promised us that you would preserve us and keep us, our spirit, soul, and body, and our mind. Our soul, our mind, our body, our spirit. And so right now, in Jesus' name, I cast off every hindrance out of this body that would cause it to not be whole. And I speak every wit hole. There will be no strokes. There will be no blood shortages. There will be no blockages. We pray complete healing now. No more. Devil, we tell you, we draw the line and we say that by his stripes, by your stripes, he is healed now. Driving out all Satan's rot and affecting the cure. Thank you for brightness of thinking, sharpness of Jesus' name. Isaiah, read Isaiah 9 and read Isaiah 11 and confess them over yourself about the brightness of thinking. Thinking about what kind of ice cream. Whatever you like, you gotta give it to you. Say, I'm gonna ask that you give me this. Nicely and politely, I'm sure. But Lord, I thank you right now that everything goes perfect in this operation on my brother. But right now, I pray that the healing anointing would go in and affect a cure and do a miracle. But even when he gets in there, he doesn't have to use these tonsils or adenoids. So, Lord, I pray you go in infection. I curse it.
Yes.
And I command everything to be whole and normal in this young man's body in this area.
Yes.
I thank you the anointing goes in and cure and drives out all sickness and disease.
Yes.
And undoes all Satan has wrought. Yes. In Jesus' name.
I got plans, and I'm going to use this little man. He is under my hand of protection. And I see singing, and I see speaking, and I see encouragement, and I see joy coming out of this voice. So great is the reward of the servant of the Lord, says the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's done. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. Well, we want a little bit longer, but with the prayer, but that's all right.
Amen.
You know, one thing that the Lord, our pastor Sherry's mouth last night, but she was praying that church isn't a convenience store. You know, the Lord says, through our church is not a convenience store, it's where family gathers.
Amen.
And it came out by the Spirit, and the Lord spoke to me immediately and said a lot of churches have become convenience stores where they just try to get them in, herd them in, do a short message and herd them out. But what about the needs of the people? God said, go teach and preach and heal.
Yes.
He didn't say, go herd them up, herd them in, and herd them out.
Amen.
He said the Sabbath was holy.
Yes.
That means a place to go and get your blessing and get rested and get filled up.
Yes.
And you need a healing, you need deliverance, you need a refreshing.
Yes.
For the rest of the week.
Yes.
So we believe in that, and guess what? The Word says it, so we're not changing.
Thank you.
Yes.
And I just want to say we love you. Every single one of you, we love you and we pray for you. And I want to say this, that when you hear a rebuke, even if it's not the right size, if you're doing the Word, that's not for you. Okay, and I just want to just quickly, because we got little ones that are growing up and we're all growing in the Lord, and you got to remember as a pastor that we're growing a whole flock of people. And what may not be, well, I'm tithing, pastors. Well, good. Then encourage someone else.
Yeah.
Amen? Because I just have really been getting that we're going up another level. And, and as a pastor, you want, the Bible says when there wasn't one feeble one among them, David didn't drive. Moses didn't drive the children of Israel. He led the sheep. Amen? And so we're moving up. But we also need to teach each other.
Yeah.
And so we're training at different levels. And so that's what we're doing. And if you are saying, hey, I'm already doing this, then just be encouraged that we thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. We're making a difference in this world. Yeah. People, we're making a difference. Faith, family, outreach, making a difference.
Yeah.
We're family.
Yeah.
Amen? But you know, some of us, we didn't have a family and we didn't know how to act. Isn't that right? And so we're trained how to act in the house of God.
Amen.
And because we love each other. Amen. And so we love you and we appreciate each one of you. And we're just giving you a hug right now. If you get out that door before we physically get to hug you, we're hugging you right now. Amen.
Amen.
And so give yourself a hug. Oh, you're feeling the love.
Yeah.
Amen. My stomach's growling. I'm feeling I need another steak. We love you. You're just missed. I'm no service tonight.